And since nobody asked for a Bible, that tells me everyone has one.
Yeah.
And that means we're a highly spiritual congregation. We got our own Bibles, man. The title of my message, though, is kind of an eye-opener. Be imitators of God. Ooh, that's heavy. Huh? Let's look around and think of it. And we don't have to look at somebody else and say, they got problems. Because we have problems.
Amen.
And we don't do a very good job of imitating God a lot of times, huh? Actually, if it wasn't by God's grace, we all just leave.
Amen.
Because we struggle with that, don't we?
Amen.
Well, let's just read what the Bible says. First four verses aloud together, please. And then we'll get into the text. Father, we thank you that we have your complete revelation of yourself in written form in the Bible. 66 books of your revelation to us over a 1,500-year period before its completion. And Father, we know that's your revelation because what was predicted in the past is being fulfilled now and beyond us still in the future. And we trust that it will because it has been fulfilled all the way down the line. So we know it's true. So Father, help us to live by your scriptures. And in doing so, to glorify your great name, to honor you properly, Lord. And for that, we need your help as we study together the scripture this morning. Ask for the empowering of your Holy Spirit to help me deliver this message from the text. And Lord, for our kids' church people to anoint them as they teach our kiddos in Jesus' name. Excuse me, amen. First four verses aloud together, please. Therefore, be imitators of God as dear children, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. But fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you as fitting for saints. Neither filthiness, nor foolish talking, nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know, and I'll read on, that no fornicator or unclean person or covetous man who is an idolater has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. That's heavy, amen. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Lost my place here.
Seven.
Thank you. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. Finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. I'll stop right there and go back over some of these verses. This is heavy charge, is it not? But I want to tell you this, that as we're led by the Holy Spirit, it's doable. We will not attain absolute perfection in this life till we get our new bodies. It's not going to happen, so we're going to be in this war. And it is a war. In our study on Friday nights, the study of grace, but our chapter we studied this past Friday was The Struggle.
Yes.
That was the title of it. And that's true. You know, sometimes when people come to Jesus, when they get saved, by the way, we have a couple sitting in the back just 2 weeks ago gave their hearts to Jesus Christ right back here after church. Yeah. Anna Maria and Oscar, will you raise your hands back there, please? Yes. Yeah. Amen. Well, we're going to dunk you in water pretty soon. We're going to figure out how we can get a baptismal service together. We might even just take you to the ocean, you know. So, you know, we do that. We used to do that regularly every year. The government provides, I think it's a Metrolink train, but they call it the beach train, and they run it every summer. And it runs from San Bernardino all the way down to below San Clemente Beach. We go to San Clemente Beach.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, it's beautiful. And right where we get off, there's the beach and the guard tower.
The pier.
Yeah, and the pier. And so we settle right in that area. So we're close to the shops. But you can carry your own stuff with you. People bring sandwiches and so on. We have a beautiful time. And I'm not a big ocean person, but I like the fellowship, you know. And then we get out in the water and we dunk them. And last time we were down there, the surf was pretty choppy.
It was.
And so we had to, I won't go in over waist deep, I'm going to tell you that anyway. So, but I had guys to help me. And I wasn't as crippled up then as I am now. So we go out in the water and we started timing it. The waves would go back out, and then we'd dunk them. And then here comes the waves again. And it almost knocked you over, you know, boom, you know. So, but it was fun, you know. And it was also sacred because we were doing it for the right purposes, honoring God through baptism by people that have given their hearts to Jesus Christ and determined to follow him by faith. And that's a visible symbol of their commitment to Jesus. And so that's what we're going to do for you guys. And there's going to be others as well, probably. So baptism coming up, and hold me to that. I'm asking that couple and the rest of us, hold me to that, because I don't want to drag my feet on baptism or water baptism. By the way, last week we studied in chapter 4 about one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And my summation, my guess in that, the one baptism is probably water baptism, because almost every church that calls itself Christian practice a form of water baptism. We do it by full immersion based on Romans chapter 6, where it says about when we go under the water, it's like we died with Christ, our old life, and we live, we come up out of the water a new creature in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So it's that symbol that we died to our old way of life, our old sinful nature. And it's still there. We still have to struggle with it. But nevertheless, we made that commitment to follow Jesus Christ. So in doing that, we have the power to overcome.
Amen.
That's good news.
Amen.
And so, be imitators of God. Paul, in another place, I think in one of the Corinthian letters, he says, be imitators of me. And I look at Jesus, and there's no way we can imitate Jesus, except in part. You know what I mean by that? When we're fully committed to the Holy Spirit's guidance, at that time we are imitating Jesus. We are not Jesus, never will be Jesus. Unlike what some teachers are teaching today, we're little gods. I'm going to tell you something. We are not little gods. And we prove that to our families every day. If you want to think you're a little God, just ask your kids or your wife or your husband. And they'll tell you, yeah, you're a God. You're a God of hell. But you know what I'm saying. But we can be in part, but God sees it when our heart is sold out to him. And even when we blow it, we confess our sins. He sees us as having never broken fellowship with him. So heaven sees us in the perfect state. We're not there yet in this state, but in heaven we are, because of our relationship with Jesus, who his salvation is eternal for us. It's good news. Be imitators of God as dear children. Think about that. The Father God in the heavens, that we used to think in some of the ways we were raised, that he was just mean, always ready to whack us when we get out of line. But now I've learned, especially, you know, I strayed for all my 20s, and then I was a prodigal son. I came back. When I came back, I began really studying the Bible, and I came to the understanding and realized that, yeah, I still blow it, but I do confess my sins on a regular basis, and I accept the fact that God sees me as righteous in His own sight because He imputed righteousness to me and to you when you and I got saved.
Amen.
And so we're righteous. I love that. And why? Because God says so. And walk in love as Christ also loved us and given Himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet-smelling aroma. That phrase is used often in the Bible because the Old Testament sacrifices were animal sacrifices. And they didn't just waste the animal. The meat was to be consumed by the priests and sometimes the families that sacrificed. And so when that aroma went up from the meat being cooked, and I love a good steak, man, I'm telling you, see. And when that steak is cooking, ah, that's a nice aroma. You know what I'm saying? And that's the symbol here that when we sacrifice ourselves to God willingly because of Jesus' sacrifice, our sacrificial act then as a Christian doesn't mean we're a great person, but that's a sweet aroma to God. We smell good to Him. I like that. Say amen to that. I changed my reading glasses again. And outside of Jesus, some things that I do, I'm foolish. These reading glasses are way out of focus. So just bear with me, please. I'm going to change back. I finally found my other pair that I've been using in a cubby hole in my car. I got lots of slots. You know, the modern cars have cup holders all over the place. So I finally found them. I just didn't pick them up today. Verse 2, and walk in love as Christ also has loved us and given Himself for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling aroma. Just know that when we do what God's will is, we smell good to Him. I like that. But fornication, which means any sexual act that's not legitimate and ordered by God, that's fornication. It comes from the Greek word porneia, which we get our word pornography from. So it covers all those illicit sexual acts. So just know that. There's not one thing that isn't covered by that word. And all uncleanness or covetousness, let it not even be named among you as is fitting for saints. It's not proper for us to behave that way anymore. We did in the past. That was part of our lifestyle. Sometimes we bragged about it. But that's degrading to us and obviously to God because we are His children. And He teaches us differently in Scripture. Oh, you're just an old fuddy-duddy. You're old-fashioned. You don't believe in the freedom, sexual freedom and all that. I said, I wasn't serving the Lord during the sexual freedom revelation in the 60s. I've been around a while, folks. You know, so I came through. Check this out. Some of you don't even know this. You young people don't even know this. The Beatniks. Remember the Beatniks? Hey, they were cool, man. They'd sit around in these clubs and listen to jazz and cool it and smoke pot. Just kick back and relax. Now, I never got involved with them. I never got into drugs. I was protected from that. But I was 7 days a week in bars. I was an alcoholic. But then here came the hippies, and the sexual freedom exploded. Yes. And the peace march came through here, and I knew a deputy sheriff, and they were assigned to those camps to make sure everything was okay with them. But he says, you wouldn't believe the sexual orgies that are going on consistently in those tents. Male with male, female with female, swapping women all around the place. He said, that's what that was. Peace, brother. And that meant just no rules. And that was the big sexual revolution. And I'm surprised that I didn't get involved in that, because I wasn't opposed to sex, illicit sex. But now I am, because God has changed my heart and mind. I know that it drags us down. It degrades us. It robs us from the, not only the pleasure of the sexual experience, and it is pleasurable, but also the purpose in that pleasure to express our love to our wife,
yes.
One wife as a male, or as a female, one husband. And our full expression of our love is experienced physically through the act of sex, as honored by God. So when we do it illegally, we dishonor that honorable application of our sexuality. We don't understand that. Our kids don't understand that. It's really degrading to us. It drags us down.
Yes, amen.
And it shames our Savior's name.
Yes,
he died for those sins, that we might not repeat them habitually. Fornication and uncleanness. And uncleanness not only has to do with uncleanliness in body and so on, but it still is connected to sexuality as well. And covetousness. That's greediness. Coveting somebody else's possession. That can be another human being, like somebody else, if you're a male, somebody else's wife, or vice versa, somebody else's husband. I want them. I want what they have. That's covetousness. That's greediness. And the Bible says that's idolatry.
Yes.
It's like worshiping idols, because you want what somebody else has. And sometimes we'll do anything to get that. And that's where the higher crimes spring from at times. Let it not even be named among you as is fitting for the saints. Doesn't belong to us. Neither filthiness nor foolish talking. Uh-oh. Even as Christians, we've got to be careful here. Nor coarse jesting, which are not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. I'm guilty of coarse jesting at times. Not in the sense that I curse like I did when I was a heathen. I had a large vocabulary. A lot of four-letter words. It was a huge vocabulary. It was foul this and foul that. And then when I got saved, God delivered me from my foul mouth and my alcoholism. It took me a while to overcome other things, but anyway, that's my sordid story. Not fitting for saints. This coarse jesting, sometimes I fall into my Don Rickles mode. And I do that with my sister-in-law, and I'm ashamed of that. I really am. And sister-in-law, don't hold me to this, because sometimes I pull a Don Rickles on her. But that's, my wife said, you carry it too far, man. There's a little truth in every joke that you have. That made me mad when she said those things. But it's true at times. And so I'm learning not to be that habitually any longer. But I think coarse jesting covers that kind of thing, and I'm guilty of it still today at times. Oh, you're the pastor? Yeah. Yeah, I'm the pastor. A lot of people think it should be PP, Pastor Perfect. Ain't so. And our brother here has been serving as a pastor for a lot more years than I am. Raise your hand, Carl, please, as Pastor Carl, and he's retired, but he can tell you that people expect perfection out of you, but we ain't. Sometimes saints are ain'ts. For this you know, verse 5, that no fornicator, unclean person, or covetous man who is an idolater, that's heavy to me, by the way, has any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. I guess the idolatry tag applied to covetousness is because whether we indulge ourselves in all these other practices or not, sometime, somewhere, we have committed the sin of covetousness. You know, there's this saying, I don't think I use it much anymore because it's changed over the years, but it's keeping up with the Joneses. You ever heard that? So your neighbor next door, a peer of yours, might work for the same company. I was a railroader for years. So railroaders, depending on the department you worked in, made pretty good money. So we could afford some decent housing and nice cars. And a joker next door got a Cadillac. And I was driving at that time, I was driving a 52 Buick Super, which is a nice car, by the way, big old. In those days, those were big cars, man. You could seat six people comfortably in them. Big old piece of metal. And I was a dumb, stupid kid, and I blew the engine in that thing because I thought it was a hot rod. But I always wanted a Cadillac. So I kind of envied that guy, but that was when I was kind of slipping away. Even then. But that my purpose in saying that is that's a form of covetousness. And it can consume you to where you go out and you go in debt over something you can't afford to keep up with the Joneses next door. Let no one deceive you, verse 6, with empty words. There's a whole lot of empty words going out from pulpits all over the country. It's emptiness. There's no substance to it. It's false teaching. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Now, I want to tell you something. God is loving and gracious and a good heavenly Father and exhibits to us through our mothers and so on his love in a womanly or a motherly fashion. So we know he loves us. He loves us deeply. But he loves us enough to discipline us.
Amen.
Something else is missing in our society.
Yeah.
Good old-fashioned discipline of children. You know, the modern movement says that humans are basically good and they're taught to be bad. Bad answer. I don't have to be a sociologist or a psychologist to know that humans are basically bad.
Amen.
Have to be taught to be good.
Yes,
and sometimes the teaching has to be somewhat painful in some way to get and keep our attention to where we can be trained by that discipline. Red, white, and blues, bruised in the USA. A young woman brought that book to me when I was in the office one time, counseling her about her brat, or her young girl. Heard from her recently, by the way. It's beautiful how God uses you despite the fact that they didn't like your counsel. She remembered and contacted me again. She found out Jolene had passed away, my wife. Anyway, she's apparently changed, but she had a lot of good things to say about me. But she brought this book in, and it was written by a preacher or a pastor, red, white, and bruised in the USA. And he took every proverb that talked about physical discipline and twist it around and say, that's not what it means. I'm not smart, but I know this when it says, spare the rod and spoiled child, it means a whooping. And a whooping doesn't mean brutality. It doesn't have to be. It can be, and it has been, yes. But those exceptions to the rules don't govern what is meant by that. It means the rod. And, older folks like me can tell you most of us grew up with parents that kind of disciplined us. My mother never had me cut the switch off the tree with which she switched me. Some parents did that. Go cut that branch off the tree. Then you do that and then they'd whack you with it. I ran away from home one time, 4 or 5 years old. I only know this by what they told me, of course. And my mother switched me all the way home from Main Street, about 5 blocks.
Wow.
And I'm doing the hop. I didn't wander off and go down to Main Street anymore. But that was good for me. It didn't affect me mentally. I don't think. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It didn't scar me. Maybe. But my mother, I'm the oldest of 3 brothers. My mother confessed to us later on that she felt that she was way too strict at times. So she confessed that. Mom had a temper. She had to have, she was a tough man. My dad was a railroad conductor and gone a lot. We would never mess with him. He was an ex-boxer. So when he was around, he didn't even have to whack us because he could punch us out, so. But anyway, so she couldn't wait till Dad got to town to do the discipline. He might be gone a couple of days. So she learned how, and she was good at it. She didn't do as good a job as the other 2 brats, those little imps that gave me trouble on Sunday mornings. And then my mother accused me of having a demon on Sunday mornings because I upset those kids as she was getting us ready to go to church. And we always went to church, always. So she called me a demon. I say I knew that wasn't right, but are you with me here? Okay. Let no one deceive you with empty words. For because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. God is angry at sin. Make no mistake about it, because we get by with it sometimes. We think, he's just kind of a easygoing God. Ain't no way, man. I'm going to tell you, if you continue in that, you're going to suffer some kind of a serious discipline. And continue in it, eventually hell, of course. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. Don't involve yourself with other people that do that stuff. Come away from the crowd. You're delivered from alcoholism. Get out of the bars, man. For you were once darkness, verse 8, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. Darkness and light, contrasted often in Scripture. It doesn't take much light to drive out darkness. Now we have these bright lights, these bright bulbs and so on. But in the old days, they would have the kerosene lamps and light those in a dark room, and it would eliminate the room pretty well, just one kerosene lamp. They could read by it, so light is always seen in a positive way, except unless it's false light, of course. Verse 9, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth. 3 words pretty well sums up 6 points of the fruit of the Spirit as recorded for us in Galatians chapter 5. For the fruit of the Spirit, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord. That's why we need to be in regular Bible study at home, self-study, and together like we're doing now, and Wednesday nights and Friday nights next door in the fellowship hall. It's good for us to be together and to study together and to learn and to help hold one another accountable. We need each other. Because if we're just left up to ourselves, with some exceptions, of course, when there's physical problems, you can't avoid that. But sometimes we get lazy.
Amen.
I can stay home, watch it on TV, man. So this will be recorded and come out this afternoon on our website. So it's nice to stay in your PJs and watch in the afternoon, you know. You don't have to come out. Hey, there's times, man, it would be a real privilege to be able to sleep in. But I can't do that. I'm committed. And I don't regret that commitment. I'll tell you that. I love this, what we do.
Amen.
And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. The next verse sounds contradictory to that. I'll try to explain. For it's shameful to even speak of those things which are done by them in secret. On one hand, we're supposed to expose them, but yet not talk about them. I think that second verse, verse 12, means probably gossip. Bringing up stuff that other people don't need to know about them. Sometimes, if we're not careful, we do that in prayer. We pray about somebody's personal problem and expose something that's nobody's business. They just ask for prayer. So I pray general prayers. God knows.
Yes.
But all things, verse 13, are exposed, that all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. One of the purposes in the Ten Commandments is not to save us from our sins, but expose what sin is so that we can come to the cross and be delivered from it.
Amen.
The Ten Commandments were never meant to change our heart. Just tell us what sin is. And then by that, we're convicted by the Holy Spirit, that sin you need to come to God and get His forgiveness. Sometimes people think that's radical, but it's true. It's true. It's that simple. The rest of it, the struggle, is not so easy. But it's doable. And the scripture we're reading today tells us that. Therefore, he says, verse 14, awake, you who sleep, arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. It says in Ephesians chapter 2, the beginning of it says, we were once, I'll paraphrase it, we were once darkness, now we're light. We were dead in our trespasses and sins. We were seen as dead men, dead women walking, zombies. Spiritual zombies is what we were. Had no clue about spiritual reality until we came to Him who is light, Jesus. I'm the light of the world. Exposing sin. Come to me. I have sacrificed myself for you so you can be forgiven of your sins. Jesus is the only human being that never sinned his whole lifetime. Awesome to me, because I'm around people even in church that are not perfect.
Yes.
But he was. The Bible's clear. He was tempted in every way that we are, yet without sin. We can't claim that apart from him and his substitutionary sacrifice for us. Arise from the dead, and Christ will give you light. See then that you walk circumspectly, not as fools but wise. Circumspectfully is in my margin, carefully. I like that better. I can pronounce it more easily. So walk carefully. Yeah. Walk means lifestyle. Redeeming the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And a lot of times we struggle with that one, don't we? I know God's called me to some service in the Lord. I know he's given me some spiritual gift, but I'm at this place where I don't know what it is. And so we don't know what the will of the Lord is a lot of times, right? That's a hard one. Took me a long time to come to the realization that I was called to teach the Bible. I thought that to say that would be like an ego trip. But it just manifests itself, and I had confirmation from pastors and other spiritual leaders. So I came to that conclusion, yeah, okay, I'm gifted. That's God's gift, so I can't brag about it. I didn't know about being a pastor. That was a hard one. At the time, I finally opened up to the fact that we could begin thinking about starting a church. I thought, oh, yeah, I served as an elder on a couple of different churches, and I did pastoral duties, visited hospitals, prayed for the sick, prayed with people, counseled them. I was doing all those kinds of things. That's what pastors do. I only knew a fraction of what pastors do. The administrative end of it, the legal things that we do as churches. If we didn't have a great secretary,
yes,
Sharon Fan, been with us a long time, a lot of that stuff wouldn't get done, or if it did get done, it'd get done slowly. I know she gets frustrated with me, I know that. Pastor, I signed this for you, is it okay? Yeah, I give her permission to sign on my behalf. Are you following me here?
Yes.
So, you know, and now I'm realizing there's far more to it than I saw on the surface, even after years of serving as a deacon or an elder, wasn't the same. But I'm not complaining. I'm glad God called me to this. Despite all my shortcomings, he still uses me. So if you're wondering about spiritual gifts or whatever, by the way, we have booklets in my office that give you an idea of what your spiritual gift might be. It's pretty good. Here's one that's clear what his will is. Verse 18, and do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Spirit. Want to know what the will of God is? Don't get drunk, in which is dissipation, which means wasteful living. And if you've ever been an alcoholic, you know it's a waste.
Or a drug addict,
but I was spared from that. You know, it was supernatural. But anyway, yeah, and my wife had tried every kind of drug there was. It's a wonder she still had her mind. But God heals our minds too, you know.
Yeah, he
did. And but she tried everything, except she wouldn't shoot up. She was afraid of needles. And then she ended up being a lifelong diabetic, 45 years having to give shots. Of course, the diabetes needle is about this long. You don't even feel it. It was to have to puncture her finger to get blood to check her sugar levels until they developed this.
Painful.
You know, later in life, she could squeeze fingers and get blood without pricking it.
Wow.
That's how often. And she was really good at it. In a restaurant, she would prick her finger and check her blood and take her insulin, and most people sitting at the table didn't know it. She became pretty crafty about that. Diabetes is horrible, by the way. If you have it or a hint of it, you better get test it and take care of it and be diligent in that. It's doable to take care of it. Anyway.
Dissipation,
wastefulness, wasteful living. And man, I wasted myself. And so did you if you were a drug addict or an alcoholic or both. You know, a lot of people got caught in both realms. In fact, we have in this church people that still are a part of AA and NA. They're still active in those programs, which are good to a point. But they don't go far enough. They don't take us to the true God, Jesus. So AA and NA say, you know, find out a higher power and go to that. But we can choose the higher power. And I thought about that. Now, wait a minute. As an alcoholic, I'm told now to overcome my alcoholism, I need to choose my God. I've been making bad choices for years. How am I going to choose a good God when I'm bad? Do you understand what I mean? And for a long time, we had a drug and alcohol class called One Step. Not 12 steps, One Step.
Yes.
One Step is guess who?
Jesus.
Amen. And those of us that have committed our lives completely to Him and have been transformed and are being continually transformed, we become overcomers.
Amen.
Rereading verse 18, and do not be drunk with wine, in which is dissipation, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Speaking to one another, verse 19, in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Most churches give a great deal of service time to singing God's praises. You know, that's part of Calvary Chapel. A lot of churches, you know, I've been involved in three different denominations. Worship and music is a big part of that. Should be. Especially, and I like the contemporary Christian music, I do a lot. But I like the old hymns too.
Amen.
You know, and the gospel is in a lot of those hymns.
Yes.
It really is. I could preach sermons from the hymn book. Anybody could. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. There are some churches that believe only in vocal music. They say instruments is only an Old Testament principle. And we remember that, you know, King David and the temple, there were those trained singers and instruments and so on, big orchestras. But they said it's only for the Old Testament times, but I don't have to be a Greek scholar to know I can read a Greek interlinear Bible, which gives you the Greek word and translation that they use to translate into English. And so just, I double checked, and I'm not going to read directly from my interlinear Bible, but it says, Psalms is music accompanied by string instruments. It says that. That's part of the definition of Psalms. It's 150 Psalms. It's the longest book in the Bible. 78 of which David wrote, and then others. But they're personal testimonies is what they are. And there was instrumental music supporting that. And I think it should be. Psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. That's a good thing when we're doing that. And it just moves us when we're singing those words. Amen?
Amen.
And it prepares us then, prayerfully, for the word to come through the teaching at the pulpit. Giving thanks, verse 20, for always for all things to God the Father in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I haven't researched this yet, but I will. How often it says give thanks. The Jews are really good at that, especially the Messianic Jews. Messianic Jews are the ones that are born again. They've accepted Jesus as Messiah. And they give thanks a lot. And it's something that we need to do, I think, more often rather than just over our meals or whatever, which we ought to do. Giving thanks always for all things to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Submitting to one another in the fear of God. And I'm going to stop because there's much to talk about in the next few verses of chapter 5 about marriages, marriage relationships. When I'm counseling or when we've counseled people in the past for marriage, I take them right to this chapter. This part of the chapter. It's not all that I use or have used, but it's very important. You might want to read ahead next week, verses 25 through the end of the chapter. It speaks to male-female relationships in the context of God-ordained marriage. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we can do these things freely. You desire that of us. For not only does it bless us, but it blesses you. Because you have told us to do this because you know it's good for us. So, Father, I pray that we'll continue to be faithful in that. And to be serious about your word, Lord, and the application in our individual lives. May we put it to practice. And we have the power when we submit to your Holy Spirit because he gives us the power to do what's right. Thank you for that. Thank you for that provision. And I pray if there's anyone here this morning, like this couple a couple of weeks ago, that are feeling it in their hearts that they want to know Jesus, that they'll come to me or Dugan at the back and talk to us about your desire to be saved, to be born again. We're in that business. So help us, Lord. Help them to respond if they're being led that way or pulled that way, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together this last song.